we're just talking with Missouri Attorney General Andrew Bailey just last hour about the suit that he's filed in our home state, Kane, of Missouri. Wentzville School District. Wentzville, which is like this pie in the sky school out in St. Charles County. Very, very beautiful county, by the way. And they were having these hidden discussions, the school board was, about gender-neutral bathrooms. And one of the school board members was on unofficial record saying, well, you know, we just don't care what the parents think about this. And then now the attorney general's involved. 42 parents spoke out. Three of the school board members blew the whistle. So thankfully, people are speaking up. But this is just, it's insanity. And this is, it is a culture war, but there is an ideology, an ideological component to it. And that's kind of what's the focus of this book. It's called Hide Your Children, Exposing the Marxists Behind the Attack on America's Kids. And it's out today. It's in stores today. My friend Liz Wheeler, who joins me via Skype, host of The Liz Wheeler Show. This is her book. Congrats on the book, by the way. I really like the cover of it, The Red Wolf. I'm just trying to figure out how we got into a society, Liz, where we have like strange adults, like these are not even like familial members, who are obsessed with bathroom policy in other people's kids' schools, or where I mean that are having these, you know, people who are on school boards that think that parents don't have a right to know what's happening in their kids' schools. It's just, we got to this point really fast because this was not a huge issue 10 years ago.
Thanks, Dana, for having me on the show. I mean, to say that it's cultural insanity that we're experiencing right now might be the understatement of the year. When I began to research just the very beginnings of this book, I was researching just as a mom, like, is this a concerted effort to target our children? Who's behind this? What is this all about? Why now? And I realized that, yes, it's certainly escalated now. We can all see that. I mean, what you were just describing is so horrendous. I mean, happening in the UK as well as in the US, happening in our home states, in the Bible Belt, like the places you least expect it. And I realized that while it is escalating, it's not new. It's the culmination of decades upon decades of the left infiltrating our institutions that were meant to protect children, and co-opting them, subverting them until they've entirely captured these institutions. I'm talking our major institutions, obviously the media, the education system, sadly, a lot of religious institutions too, the law, the family, and in particular, the element of the nuclear family, the children. It maybe is the last element left standing. So what I do in my book is I trace each of these things. I name the names of the people and the organizations behind the capture of these institutions, behind the attack on America's kids. And then once we've established the reality of this political enemy that we're facing, who they are and what they want, I offer a solution that, Dana, I will tell you is different than what the Republican Party offers for how we can take back these institutions and save our kids. Because what the Republican Party has been doing the last 15 years is not working, or we wouldn't be where we are today.
Well, yeah, I wonder if some of them even know like the concept of critical race theory. I remember the whole issue of Derrick Bell and Barack Obama, and I was writing about this in 2012, and it seemed really weird that this was going to replace like the economic class warfare, getting into this like the cultural construct warfare, which is where we are now. But the Republican Party, there are a lot of Republicans that don't understand the importance of this, that think, like, for instance, like the fight against Disney. There was some like old crusty Republican fundraiser who's like, oh, it's not necessary to do all this. Well, it wasn't like it was the Florida legislature or the governor's idea of Florida to get involved in this. These were parents who were livid that what was being presented, for instance, as Black history was literally, it was a class called queer theory. I don't understand how that goes into Black American history or Black history at all, but that was what was being presented and packaged into this veneer of Black history and sold to kids, like, you know, in seventh grade, eighth grade even. So these were parents that were speaking out about this. Why do some Republicans, Liz, why is there, is it just they don't see it, the importance of it, do you think, or is it that they are just stupid to the concept, for the lack of a better way to put it? Because I just can't imagine, you know, all of the policy stuff is downstream from culture. I don't understand why they don't see the importance of this fight.
Well, let me give you a perfect example of this, because I think a lot of conservatives have been blithely unaware. We've been complacent. Part of the reason that parents have been complacent is because they didn't realize this was happening.
True.
But the people that should have been the ones to ring this bell, this warning bell, our politicians fighting back against it, our media, just choose not to believe it. It's not convenient for them. They don't want to talk about issues that are uncomfortable or moral. They just want to go to their DC cocktail parties and not deal with the issues that actually impact our families. So this example is Governor Chris Christie was on CNN about 2 weeks ago, and he was asked about some of these states around the country that have been banning transgender surgeries for kids. And he was asked, why don't you support that if you are against these transgender surgeries for kids? And Christie says, listen, I don't support the surgeries, but I don't think it's government's right to step in and tell parents what they can do or not do with their children. It needs to be parents' decision whether they can mutilate the bodies of their children in the name of gender ideology. And I saw that, Dana, and I was like, he's a perfect example of what I'm talking about when I say the Republican Party has gotten it wrong. Because the Republican Party defines freedom as the ultimate end. As long as someone has the freedom to do something, that must be good and right and moral. And that's not true. If it were true, then what David French said when he once said that drag queen story hour was a blessing of liberty, there'd have to be something inherently good about these grown men dressed as sexualized versions of women gyrating in front of women. But I reject that there's anything good about that. It's grotesque. It's immoral. It's evil. So the Republican Party must be getting the definition of liberty wrong. It must be that the definition of liberty is that freedom is the means to something greater. But Republican politicians have lost sight of this or refused to grapple with this question, because in order to answer that question, what is something greater? What is this something greater? What does human flourishing look like? How do we use the just authority of government to enact these ends in our society? They have to think about and wrestle with moral issues, which is the last thing that politicians in Washington, D.C. want to do.
No, there isn't any morality there. I mean, it's like the godless, you know, trying to lecture about God. That's kind of what it is. Liz Wheeler, her new book, Hide Your Children, Exposing the Marxist Behind the Attack on America's Kids. You also get into the ESG guidelines as well, which I think the best way to describe this, because I've had people say, if you had to break that down into like an elevator pitch, I mean, it's basically like China's, you know, behavioral credit score, but just apply it to every aspect of your life, financial, everything. I mean, I was just reading about how there was more financial penalties being applied. This is here in the United States. I can't find this headline. But tell me a little bit about that, because you include that in this as well. So after they go through school, if they are able to like come out of, you know, that process, if they're not homeschooled — homeschool your kids, by the way, everybody, if you can — if they are able to come out in one piece from the school system, and then they go out into the workplace, they're probably going to be now discriminated against based on their ideology. If things keep going this way because of these, the behavioral, you know, the ESG, it's like Chinese behavioral credit score. I mean, ultimately, that's what it is.
It is. And it's actually even worse than that, because children are suffering the repercussions of ESG when they're still in school, when they're still young children, when they're still under 10 years old, even, because it's not just that they're going to run into this when they apply for a job. It's not just that they're going to be forced to undergo DEI training once they've been hired. It's that these woke corporations that produce products for children, including Disney or, you know, Bud Light is a perfect example of this, although they're not producing a product for children. But Disney's a good example. Build-A-Bear is a good example of it. I mean, Target, all of these different places. The reason that they are embracing this so-called wokeness is because it earns them points on their ESG score. And they need a high ESG score if they want to participate in our market. Because these big financial institutions like BlackRock and Bank of America, who determine whether you get loans and whether you can survive in the market, at least for these big corporations, is forcing these corporations to virtue signal and embrace wokeness, or else they're being penalized in the market. So these big corporations that are targeting our children with really poisonous stuff. We all remember those videos of the Disney executive that says we are intentionally inserting a queerness agenda into our children's programming. It's not because that profits them, Dana. They've lost an incredible amount of money producing these woke films. It's because they're pursuing a high ESG score. So as long as that's something that governs our corporations in our country, and it is already here, it's not something that we're predicting will happen, it's already here. As long as that's a legal thing to do, then wokeness in our corporations is never going to be solved, and it's never going to be something that the corporations walk back just based on backlash or boycotts from conservatives.
Yeah, true. That's a good way to put it. Yeah, the ESG guidelines. We're proud, Kane, to have a negative 50,000 ESG score here on the show. I think that's how we got to start doing it. The book is Hide Your Children, Exposing the Marxists Behind the Attack on America's Kids. It is out today. Liz Wheeler, congratulations on the book. This is a good discussion. We got to talk with you again soon.
Thanks, Dana. I appreciate it.
Good to see you.